Well, good morning. Thank you, Dixon, for the kind introduction. And it's really a distinct pleasure for me to be here and be able to talk a little bit about, you know, the activities or my academic activities in the lab. I'm going to try to summarize, you know, my talk in three main topics. The main topic to discuss today probably will be a total pancreatectomy and islet autotransplantation and how the program has evolved. And I'm going to try to summarize the results and what is the current literature. In addition to, you know, the islet autotransplant program, we are heavily involved in the what is called the integrated islet distribution program. And that is a center in which six programs across the country are being funded in order to foster research using human islets. So we are basically, since 2006, we've been funded by NIH and the City of Hope in order to distribute islets to researchers across the country so where they can actually do research in many areas. And last but not least is something that is very close to my heart right now is basically complement biology and the implications for organ donation and transplantation. That's something that my lab has been working for the last 3 years, and we're very excited about these preliminary results. I have to confess a little bit of my sins. I have some conflict of interest with pharma. They have provided some preliminary funding, you know, for the research, and they have provided drugs. I have to mention that this partnership has been triggered by our scientific interest rather than, you know, the other way around. Chronic pancreatitis for the youngsters in the group is certainly characterized by irreversible continued destruction of the pancreatic acinar and ductal cells element. These cells are replaced by fibrous tissue and deposition of extracellular matrix. And unfortunately, this is a progressing process that lead to destruction of the insulin-producing cells. This actually cartoon summarize essentially what is the progression. What we see on the left upper corner is a mild inflammatory process of the gland. Going to the right-hand side, there is some severe inflammation. Now, the gland is not only involved, but the adjacent tissue start to get some changes that unfortunately lead to communication of the parenchyma and the acinar and the pancreatic duct to the outside elements, creating pseudocysts, then the recurrence inflammation that lead to a severe acute pancreatitis with extrapancreatic and interpancreatic necrosis. That unfortunately leads to a progression in which we see dilatation of the pancreatic duct with calcifications and unfortunately an end-stage chronic pancreatitis, which lead to pancreatic insufficiency, destruction of islet mass, and these actually can be not only tremendously debilitated for patients, but certainly lethal. This is probably a picture that the most experienced surgeons here maybe saw years back, in which, you know, patients were trying to get some treatment for them. Then, you know, bags with warm saline was put in the back in order to palliate their pain. Of course, this didn't do anything. The treatment of chronic pancreatitis is essentially medical as at the first phase. And the way that people treat this is abstinence of alcohol, low-fat diet, supplemental pancreatic enzymes when there is already some signs of pancreatic insufficiency, and the non-narcotic utilization. That is what is called the first line of treatment, of course. And then once that failed, GI endoscopies, what they do is that they do an ERCP and they try to actually stent the pancreatic duct in order to be able to not only dilate, and kind of break the stricture, but at the same time, they can eliminate some calcifications in the pancreatic duct using lithotripsy. In many occasions, this actually is not a definitive procedure. It's rather a bridging procedure. And unfortunately, the solution of these problems is surgery. I still don't understand why people do celiac plexus injection, for patients that have chronic pancreatitis. Guys, that doesn't work. This is only for palliating pain for patients that are not a surgical candidate for pancreatic cancer. So really, celiac plexus injection should be eliminated from the lingo in terms of treatment for chronic pancreatitis. Until recently, I think that, surgeons were only referred patients with severe chronic pancreatitis who were malnourished, often abusers of alcohol or narcotics, who has an end-stage glandular disease. And the truth is that improvement in pain and diminished frequency and severity of attacks were the sole determinants of the successful surgical outcomes. And prevention of diabetes development was never a goal in the management of chronic pancreatitis, or at least not the primary goal, to better state it. So what we're trying to do here is to shift a little bit what is the treatment for chronic pancreatitis. And the goal now, instead of being centering about elimination of pain and increasing quality of life, is basically to try to save as much of the beta cell mass in order to preserve endogenous insulin secretion and either prevent surgical diabetes or minimize the magnitude of the diabetes that we induce with the surgical procedure. An equally important goal is to maintain patients' narcotic independence. So the aims of islet autotransplantation after total pancreatectomy is essentially of pancreatitis-associated complications to adjacent organs, preservation of endocrine pancreatic function, social and occupational rehabilitation, and last but not least, improvement in quality of life. The well-accepted indications for total pancreatectomy and islet autotransplantations are essentially severe chronic pancreatitis, benign mucinous cysts of the pancreas, that requires a significant resection of the gland. So therefore, it will be beneficial perhaps, to save the majority of the islets in order to be able to try to minimize the surgically induced diabetes. Benign insulinomas with close proximity to vascular or ductal structures that preclude enucleation. Cystadenomas of the pancreas, or a salvage procedure, how we call it, which is actually patients that went into a previous pancreatectomy, whether it's a Whipple or a Pousteau, and have failed in terms of pain control and required completion of pancreatectomy. And we have a handful of those in our series. University of Minnesota has been leading the chart probably in what is called total pancreatectomy and islet autotransplantation, and they have accumulated approximately 450 cases over the last 25 years. They have actually defined what are the criteria for total pancreatectomy and islet autotransplantation. They should have one of those A, B, or C, and also section 2, which will be the following slide. Essentially, A is determination by the radiographic means that the patient have chronic pancreatitis, whether it is by CT scan or MR, or endoscopic ultrasound meeting 6 out of the 9 criteria, and I'm not going to bore you with that, with those criteria, or at least they should have a secretin MRCP. What they do is that basically they inject a secretin, and what that allows is a visualization of the pancreatic duct, and they take images every 10 minutes for an hour. Meeting endoscopic ultrasound criteria or an endoscopic procedure in which they inject secretin and they measure the amount of bicarbonate that is being released by the pancreas. If they don't meet criteria A, they should meet criteria B or C. Criteria B is basically a relaxing acute pancreatitis. and patients must have at least 3 bouncers of acute pancreatitis and ongoing episodes for over 6 months, and no evidence of current gallstone disease or correctable etiology, such as autoimmune pancreatitis, or a documented hereditary pancreatitis with shown genotype markers that are already available. Patients must have these criteria present. Patients must have a chronic narcotic dependency and is being defined as the utilization of narcotics over 3 months. Impaired quality of life defined by one of the followings: loss of a job, inability to significantly reduce or significantly reduce ability to work or to attend school, frequent abstinences to school, frequent hospitalizations, and ability to participate in usual age-appropriate disease. And this is actually more related to the series for pediatric patients. They should have a complete evaluation to make sure that the patients do not have a reversible etiology, unresponsive to maximal medical therapy or endoscopic therapy. And I think that probably the medical folks tend to abuse a little bit about these endoscopic procedures. I would say if you have failed twice, please refer it to us. We can probably take care of patients from that point. I do think that there is a merit, you know, to try to be non-invasive to start with. But certainly, for instance, I saw a patient yesterday in clinic with 6 attempts of pancreatic duct stenting and dilatation. Too much. And we must, and this is something that is important, we must actually document that patients have adequate islet cell function, because that's certainly what we're targeting here, to preserve islet mass. Patient must not have any of the following contraindications: active alcoholism. As you can imagine, trying to actually maintain these patients off narcotics and off alcohol is a tremendous duty, and we don't want to actually deal with this dual substance abuse. Pancreatic cancer patients are probably contraindicated for this, although there is a trial currently in Germany in which patients that have pancreatic cancers are being candidates for islet autotransplantation. Patients that have end-stage pulmonary disease, like cystic fibrosis, or patients that have a severe atherosclerotic disease should be considered a contraindication for islet autotransplantation. Poorly controlled psychiatric illness, inability to comply with postoperative regimen, or patients that have illegal drug abuse. Those are actually contraindications for autotransplantation. This cartoon, probably you have seen it in the past on previous talks. What we're trying here is to illustrate what islet autotransplantation is. Once we actually remove the gland, we're able, through a mechanical and enzymatic process, convert the pancreas into a milkshake, like a slurred of pancreas. And what we're trying to do then is to deliver that, again, back to the patient. And what we do that is through a cannulation of the portal vein, whether that is done in the operating room or is done percutaneously in the GI suite in radiology. So what we do through gravity is that we allow the islets to lodge in the presinusoidal space that you can see in the left lower corner, and then the islets will be able to not only sense for glycemia, but they will be able to actually get reinnervated, revascularized, and then sense for glucose elevation and release insulin. What we do here, and a couple of members of my labs are here, is to take the pancreas after being flush in the operating room. We debride all the extra vessels that we do not need. We cannulate the pancreatic duct using angiocath in order to be able to deliver a combination of collagenase and neutroprotease in order to facilitate the digestion. Here is the distension of the gland with this mix of collagenase and neutroprotease. And what we're trying to do is to basically place the pancreas in that chamber that was created by Camilo Recorded. The truth of the matter is that there is no automatic method here. This was, you know, written in 1988 in the journal Diabetes. There's nothing automatic about this. This is all, you know, shaking and sweating, trying to actually get the pancreas digested through a mechanical and the enzymatic process. And what we do is that we use a peristaltic pump in order to be able to recirculate the enzyme and be able to facilitate the digestion, maintaining the temperature of the collagenase around 37 degrees. So what we do and we're hoping is to essentially obtain a specimen that is like that, in which just the skeleton of the gland. We have been able to digest successfully the pancreas. And what we see under the microscope is an image that it looks like this. The spheres in red are islet or conglomerate of beta cells. And the reason that they are staying in red is because we use a syntropic dye that is called DT-SUN in order to be able to actually visualize it and differentiate it from the acinar component, which is the cream spheres that you see there in the monitor. At this point in time, depending on the volume that we obtain, we decide as to whether do an additional step and purify the preparation or actually provide the entire milkshake of pancreas into the liver. And that actually depends on the risk that we want to take for X or Y patient in terms of volume. If we actually obtain more than 0.25 cc per kilogram of body weight of preparation, then we are more prone to actually go to an extra step and purify the preparation, because what happened is that the rate of thrombosis or bleeding is directly proportional to the volume that is being delivered and also to the pressure in the porta vein that we obtain at the time of the infusion. That's something that we do at the time that we infuse the islet. We put a catheter in the porta vein, and then we connect it to an A-line, and we measure a porta venous pressure. We try not to exceed 25 centimeters of water. And here is actually a publication also from the group in Minnesota in which they depict time or tissue volume per porta venous pressure. And you can see in the left upper quadrant, you know, as you start to increase the porta venous pressure, you actually have a greater incidence of thrombosis and bleeding. So what we're trying is to essentially minimize volume and then, of course, minimize the postoperative risks. The purification step is being done through a machine that was used way, way back in order to actually separate blood products in blood banks. And then, you know, the Islet group have rescued those, you know, from the basements of every hospital and have restarted to utilize the 2991 COVE machine. This is not being utilized in any other place but Islet labs. And through a density gradient, we're capable to essentially separate islet from the acinar. Acinar tend to be heavier, islet tend to be lighter. So we can actually separate the islets. And looking at a prep on the left upper corner is a purified islet in which, you know, purity is over 90%. And then what we do is we look at viability of the islet based on the fluorescent diacetate and propidium iodine. And then what we do is that we stain the islet, we look at it under the microscope, and we count the particles that are green and the particles that are red. The particles that are green are the ones that are viable. The particles that are red are the ones that are dead or in the process of dying. This is actually a histology of one of our patients in which we took biopsies about a month after transplantation, in which we can see that actually that the islet are lodging in the presinusoidal space. And then in the left lower corner, we see an immunoperoxidase staining for insulin. So those islets were already producing insulin, and they were sensing for the glycemia control. So what we're trying to achieve with islet autotransplantation is a steady state control in which we maintain glycemia quite well. These are actually an example of four patients in which we put a continuous glucose monitoring and we try to actually assess glycemia control over time. Essentially, the peaks and valleys is what kill patients in long term, and those are being associated with secondary complications of diabetes. So what we try to do is to maintain glycemia control, as we see here in this slide. This is actually an old slide, but it's quite relevant. And this is from the Islet Transplant Registry that was working in Germany, not any longer in Germany, now it's in Minnesota, in which we see that if patients were to get over 300,000 islets equivalent, an islet equivalent is nothing but the unit in which we measured islet size. All sizes are created in different ways. There are different sizes. The ideal islet size is 150 microns. So what we do is that we actually, in order to be able to speak universally, we relate our preparations to islets equivalent. In other words, big islets and small islets are converted into a unit measurement that is 150 microns. So if we were to actually transplant a patient over 300,000 islets equivalent, we have a chance in 12 months of having someone insulin dependent in about 71% of the time. So there is an interesting paper that was published recently in which they actually did a correlation between histopathological findings of pancreases that were used for islet isolation, and then whether the islet yield that they were able to obtain afterward. There is essentially two things that limit the yield of islet at the end of the procedure. One of them is the chronicity of the pancreatitis, and the other one is as to whether patients have a previous surgical procedure or not. As we can see here, from left upper to the bottom, we can see that this is a beautifully preserved bad pancreas in which we can see acinar and islet and the vascularization of the islet. And as we actually move down to the other four, the other three figures, we can see that the pancreas has been replaced by fibrous tissue. And unfortunately, we see in the left corner a pancreas in which not only has been replaced by fibrous tissue, but there is no islets in the slide. So obviously, the chronicity of the problem lead you to fibrosis tissue deposition, and unfortunately, that is detrimental to the islet yield. What we can see here is a direct correlation between fibrous tissue, degree of acinar atrophy, degree of inflammation, and a little bit of softer, but nevertheless, a correlation with the degree of necrosioblastosis. So these correlations actually are very important, and in every specimen that we process, we take a biopsy as a quality control just to see whether the isolation failed as a result of a bad processing or failed just because we unfortunately have a pancreas that has been replaced by significant amount of fibrous tissue. The other thing that I was mentioning about that is limiting the islet yield is previous surgery. In the light gray corner, we can see those patients that have never had a previous surgical resection. And after attempts by endoscopies to plate stentings in the pancreatic duct, those patients were referred to us for total pancreatectomy and islet autotransplantation. What we see is that the islet equivalent yield is about 5,000 islet equivalent per kilogram of body weight. And the following bars represent patients that have a Whipple procedure. The next one is a distal pancreatectomy. And the last but not least is a Pousteau procedure. So what happened is if you actually are exposing the pancreas, to a bowel content, that is going to be promoting an autodigestion of the gland, and therefore the islets are going to be destroyed. We have done actually a couple of patients after Pousteau in which we have trying to do a salvage procedure, and the yield of islets were very, very limited. So, of course, the more islets we are capable to rescue, the greater is the chance that the patient will be insulin independent. And we can see that on the side in which, you know, the rate of insulin independent is about 40% for those patients that never have a surgical procedure. This is actually a slide from one of the Minnesota's manuscripts in which they talk about the narcotic utilization over time. About 50% of them actually were narcotic independent 24 months after. The rate of pancreatic pain have dropped from 97% to 23%. And the pain rating that was oscillated between a scale between 10 and 100 initially was 66 and had dropped to 44, 24 months. I think that we have actually done a little bit better in terms of our results in narcotic utilization. But nevertheless, this is a great accomplishment if you actually were to compare those results with patients that have more conventional resections. Also, they look at the quality of life of patients after total pancreatectomy and islet auto transplantation. And what is actually interesting is that there is an improvement over time. And the improvement actually is independent as to whether patients can be insulin independent or not, as you can see in the right-hand corner. So there are some new indications, and this is actually a paper that was published last year by the Milan group, the group of Lorenzo Piemonte. And basically, they are also considered, in addition to the indications that I mentioned previously, patients that have severe complications after pancreatic surgery, in which, you know, the fistula is being graded as a gray C. In other words, those are the ones that are leaking, and then the patient, the surgeons are considering whether, you know, to take the extra pancreas out or attempt to save the anastomosis. And actually, these patients are being considered for in a randomized fashion to do a salvage procedure using the residual pancreas for auto transplantation. Patients that are undergoing pancreatic duodenectomy in whom the pancreatic anastomosis was deemed at high risk for leakage, those patients are actually also being randomized, you know, for auto transplantation versus proceeding with the anastomosis, or patient undergoing extensive distal pancreatectomy for benign borderline neoplasm located in the pancreatic body and neck, in which a lot of the pancreas is going to be resected. One of the things that also is interesting is the result of in pediatric population. We have not done any total pancreatectomy and added auto transplantation at our institution for the pediatric population. But the results are actually quite satisfactory. We see patients that are being diagnosed early in the pre-adolescent stage who success is actually greater in the pre-adolescent age versus adolescent, in which islet equivalent per kilogram is greater, and then, of course, the duration of the disease is shorter. It's important not only to mention the experience from Minnesota, but to mention the experience from Cincinnati. They recently actually presented their experience at the American Surgical Association Congress last April, in which 156 patients received a total pancreatectomy and islet auto transplantation. Their survival at 5 years was 89%, no mortality. 1 and 5 years narcotic independency was between 55 and 77%. And their insulin dependent was noticed to decline over time, 38% of them at 1 year and 28% at 5 years. The median hemoglobin A1C was at 6.9%. Their range between 5.5 and 8.3. And they conclude in their in their presentation that durable pain relief and improvement in the quality maintenance of glycemia control could be achieved with total pancreatectomy and islet autotransplantation. These slides actually summarize our experience of 18 patients. I have to thank Nancy Radke for providing all that information and also for the extraordinary care that she had provided to these patients. We have 18 patients that we have done so far, including the one that we just did on Monday. Three patients that have an alcohol-induced pancreatitis, three patients with hereditary pancreatitis, three patients with idiopathic, and six patients with pancreatic division. Three other patients with other etiologies. The complete pain resolution is about 60%. And four patients that has been done over the last 3 months are being currently weaned down from narcotics utilization. If they continue doing what they've been doing over the last 4 months, I think that we're going to have probably about 80% narcotic elimination in our series. They've been winning down actually quite well. The average hemoglobin A1C for the entire series is about 8%. 15 patients are insulin independent. 44% of the patients are requiring less than 10 units of insulin per day. The average hemoglobin A1C, if you were to put these 65% patients, are about 6.35%, which is actually quite remarkable. You have to consider that if you maintain hemoglobin A1C less than 7, the chances of you developing secondary complications related to the diabetes is less than 5%. 9 out of 18 patients that receive a total pancreatectomy and autotransplantation were patients that previously have a surgical procedure, and then therefore we came as a rescue procedure. 22% of the patients required 10 to 15 units of insulin with adequate metabolic control, and their current hemoglobin A1C is around 7%. 16% of the patients, on insulin pump and required over 20 units of insulin, and one of the patients actually failed an islet prep and received a pancreas transplantation, and he's doing that quite well. So the facts that I want you to kind of take home is that, when 5,000 islets equivalent per kilogram are being retrieved and transplanted, we have a chance of about 65 to 72% of achieving insulin independence. And that is durable. And the series and the University of Minnesota has been able to successfully follow patients even up to 15 years and remain in insulin independent. This is in contrast, of course, to a failure if we are not able to retrieve that amount of islet. If we actually are only able to transplant about 2,500 islets equivalent per kilogram of body weight, the chances of remaining insulin independent is somewhere between 12 and 15%. Other factors associated with insulin independence include the lack of prior pancreatic surgery, the presence of high C-peptide, of course. And the impact of prior pancreatic surgery can be quite dramatic, with an approximately 50% reduction in islet yield in patients who have a Pousteau procedure or a distal pancreatectomy. So in conclusion, and to finish up this part of my talk, pancreatectomy with autologous islet transplantation can alleviate pain from chronic pancreatitis in more than 80% of the patients and prevent the development of surgical-induced likelihood of preventing post-surgical-induced diabetes depends on the timely referral of patients to prevent further autodigestion of the gland. And the management of chronic pancreatitis once initial endoscopic attempt has failed depends on the multidisciplinary team. Islet transplantation provides an effective and efficient way to return patients back to their own insulin-producing cells. There has been conversations in the corridor about, trying to build a multidisciplinary team in which we actually discuss patients with chronic pancreatitis. And there has been also discussions about whether we should randomize these patients in order to be able to really understand whether, you know, a distal pancreatectomy, a pusto, probably have better long-term results than a total pancreatectomy, an islet, or a transplantation. I think that that's something that we owe to the literature, and we owe to our patients in order to be able to find a much reliable way to care for these patients. But there is no doubt that these are patients that are quite complex. It takes somewhere between 3 to 6 months to get them narcotics-free. I always tell my patients that they need to get worse before they get better. And it's actually quite a debilitating disease. But we're very pleased, and I think that we're after something quite meaningful. And we're very excited to work with the people that I have been working and looking forward to increase the numbers. The other part of my talk is about, you know, the Islet Distribution Center, and I'm going to say just couple of words about it. We've been actually distributing islets again to researchers across the country, and that actually was based on the necessity that studying human islet biology. The reason for that is there was a seminal paper published by the group in Miami in which they compared the islet biology and even the distribution of the cells that form an islet in rodents, in monkeys, and in humans. And the distribution and the networking inside the cells is very different between rats, monkeys, and humans. So there was a significant, this actually resonated in the islet community. And the NIDDK have made an extraordinary effort to support research in human islets rather than rodent islets. So they have actually provide support, you know, in two different cycles. We've been lucky to be able to be part of both cycles of funding. The first one was through the Islet Cell Resource Center. Actually, Dixon was a PI in Northwestern at the time with his islet lab. And then we have continued with the Integrated Islet Distribution Program. And we are currently 6 centers across the country who are distributing islets all throughout. And as you can see, this busy table, and I apologize for that, is actually showing the multitude of projects that are being supported by the Islet Cell Distribution Consortium. We are basically studying preservation of beta cell mass, how do they differentiate metabolism, glucose homeostasis, cell signaling and regulation, and also we're serving as kind of a framework for people that are trying to create new forms of insulin-producing cells. So we have distributed about probably 10 million islets so far over the last 6 years, and we're looking forward to continue that contribution to the scientific community. Other contributions that we have provided to the literature is the UW Comprehensive Islet Quality Control Assessment, which has become a standard for many labs around the world, a standardization of protocols to ship islets to remote transplant centers, as well as islet cell biology centers. And that was actually quite exciting. The first shipment was done in the middle of February, and people received nothing but ice cubes. So then we said we need to actually standardize this, and you know, that resulted into a standardization that is being following right now nationwide. Islet biology from donation after brain death, multicenter analysis of novel and established variables associated with successful human islet isolation, and last but not least is donor pretreatment to improve islet potency and function. And this work has been done in islet, and also now is being done in kidney transplantation. So before I wrap up this part of my talk, I'd like to thank the people that have contributed to the success of the program. Hans has been an incredible supporter of this program, and he has actually been the surgeon of record for the majority of these cases. And I've been with my group doing the isolation and coming back with the prep and proceeding with the auto transplantation. Sebastian Danovetia was part of a team of isolators for about 5 years. Until now, he was promoted promoted as a first-year resident. Peter Chevlex and Laura, that has been extraordinary in the lab in order to be able to accomplish successful isolations. The transplant clinic, the UW, OTD, interventional radiology, operating room, and a special mention to Nancy Racky, who is our coordinator that work up the patients and is capable to manage narcotics, pancreatic insufficiency like no one else. Thank you, Nancy. Just to finish my talk, I'm going to talk a little bit about facts in organ transplantation and what we're doing over the last 3 years. The majority of transplanted organs are being recovered from brain death donors. OPTN data and literature support or suggest that organs from living donors outperform those from deceased donors in terms of graft survival, patient survival, and delayed graft function. Ischemic injury resulting from brain death induces an inflammatory response that is detrimental to organ quality. And this is actually a graphic that shows that indeed we're doing more deceased donors than living donors nowadays. So what is happening with brain death? Brain death, essentially what it does is induce an ischemia reperfusion injury-like. There is a release of pro-inflammatory cytokines. There is a release of acute phase proteins by the liver. There is a milieu of chemokines and cytokines that allows a chemoattraction of neutrophils and macrophages that are being recruited in the organs that were transplanted. There is a damage and apoptosis and necrosis in those organs that release what we call danger-associated molecular patterns, or DAMs. And those are being released, and that produces a vicious circle in which more chemokines, more cytokines, more neutrophils and macrophages are being migrated to the organ that we're transplanting. So this is an area that actually has not been studied very well in transplantation. And the truth of the matter is that we haven't capitalized about ways that we can treat our donors in order to improve their quality before we proceed with transplantation. So what we are trying to do is to figure out ways in the lab in which we can design a donor pretreatment management in order to minimize this acute inflammatory process that we know that not only is detrimental to the function of the organs, but will increase immunogenicity and organ rejection. So, and this is actually very simply shown in this graphic. If we were to actually compare the two bars in red, this is actually standard criteria donors on the left side, which half-life is about 10.5 years. If we were to compare with a living donor with the same identical match, it would be 17.8 years. So there is something that is happening at the time of brain death induction that is imprinting some that unfortunately is impacting in the quality of life of these organs. The same thing happens if we were to actually compare the bar in which standard criteria donors are being compared, that the one that has six antigen match, with six antigen match on the living donor. We have actually doubled the amount of half-life if we were actually were to transplant living donors with identical match. So it's not basically incompatibility in terms of the HLA system. It's rather a damage that occurs at the time of brain death that actually is detrimental to the biology of those organs. The truth of the matter is that something that you know, there is some cycles in all our specialties, and probably in 2003, 2004, it became really hot, the discovery of antibody-mediated rejection. And everybody was starting to talk about complement-mediated processes and how that occur. So some of the graft that actually, when I was a fellow, I transplanted, and I said, this never worked, and why? We started to understand that those were antibody-mediated rejection from preformed antibodies that were depositing in the graft and were causing damage and chronic changes to the graft. So I start to read a little bit about complement, and I start to say that, wow, complement is not only what we learn in medical school, in which is a way that we can, through an opsonization process, we can eliminate microorganisms that are attacking us. Perhaps, you know, complement can be involved in other areas. And we see a tremendous versatility of the complement system. And that actually is not only in the innate immune aspect, in which, you know, they actually crosstalk between coagulation and toll-like receptors and also effectors of the inflammatory process like neutrophils and macrophages, but also they provide signals to the bone marrow. They allow the releasing of pluripotent cells that are on the DC or dendritic cell line, and those actually will eventually prime T cells, you know, to foster the amplification and response. So there is actually a link through the APC or the antigen presenting self in order to condition this priming of T cells to provide an amplified adaptive immune response. There is also the complement is working on tissue repair, is working on angiogenesis, is working on elimination of apoptotic cells. So the complement actually over time has evolved and tried to actually match a newly phylogenetic pathways that are younger than at the complement, which is a very ancient system, you know, to provide defense for organisms. So we decide to actually explore the possibility, what about if we treat with complement inhibitors donors in order to eliminate that inflammatory response that we have been observing and trying to actually mitigate some of the damage that we have seen that unfortunately lead to a lower graft survival. So the overarching goal over the last 3 years has been to investigate the patterns of complement activation in brain death donors and to test the efficacy of recombinant human C1 inhibitor in hoping that if we were to treat the donors, we would actually eliminate the possibility of delayed graft function, which we know is very deleterious to the graft. We also wanted to investigate whether the use of C1 inhibitor could inhibit fibrosis or, you know, disorganize the position of collagen into the graft. And last but not least, whether C1 inhibitor could potentiate the regulation of T-cell response from inhibiting the initiation phase of Th1 effector cells or response and increasing perhaps by accumulation of C1 in the graft a more lineage into a T-regulatory cell. So what we decide initially is to target upstream of the classic pathway of complement. And we decide to use C1 inhibitor, not only because it will act on the classic pathway, but we'll be able to also, because of stoichiometric similarities between the receptors, to inhibit the MAPs on the mannose van Don lectin pathway and inhibit the activation also of the MLB pathway. So what we decide to do is to use a model like this, in which we induce a brain death in non-human primates, and then we treat donors with C1 inhibitors versus vehicle. The recombinant human C1 inhibitor have a short half-life, so the dose is needed to be repeated every 3 hours. And what we did is, after 8 hours of brain death, we recover the organs, cold storage for 40 hours, and proceed to the transplantation. So this is actually to really reproduce delayed graft function. If you recall, those that have rotated in a service, we try to minimize cold ischemia time. Normally, the average cold ischemia time in our service goes between 12 to 16 hours at most. So this is actually a very extreme model in order to actually see whether C1 inhibitor given to as a donor pretreatment strategy could prevent the development of delayed graft function. There was an interesting finding. We were able actually to prevent delayed graft function in the first two animals, and we were not able to reproduce that with C1 inhibitor. And going back, to our note, we realized that heparin could actually potentiate the action of C1 inhibitor. And we encounter a publication like this in which we see that the potentiation factor of heparin with C1 inhibitor can be up to 58 folds. So therefore, what we decide to do is to add an additional arm in which not only C1 inhibitor was utilized, but was utilized in combination with heparin. And what we do see is the following result. Donors that were treated with C1 inhibitors did not or were not able to delay graft function. However, the addition of C1 inhibitor with heparin have a dramatic drop in the model in terms of not only graft survival, but also serum creatinine over time. These animals were sacrificed at day 30 since we were able already to satisfy our goal, which was to prevent delayed graft function. What we look at here is the average serum creatinine of patients that receive vehicle compared to the patients that receive C1 inhibitor plus heparin. And we see that there is a dramatic difference in terms of serum creatinine at the time of euthanasia. If we actually were to look at the average changes in serum creatinine between postoperative day 1 and 4, we see a dramatic differences in serum creatinine between vehicle-treated animals and control. And if we actually were to look at the histological findings, what we see is that patients that receive organs that were treated with C1 inhibitors with heparin, we see no migration of macrophages, no migration of neutrophils to the graft, and the site architecture of the kidney is completely preserved. In contrast, if we actually were to look at untreated animals, and this is a biopsy at day 5, we see a significant amount of vacuolization of the cytoplasm in the tubular structures of the cortex and medulla of the transplanted kidney. And there is a typical finding that is called the hobnail, and you can see that in the red line, in which basically it's a complete distortion of the tubular architecture of the kidney. In contrast, this is a biopsy of day 5 of animals that receive kidneys from donors that were treated with C1 inhibitor with heparin, in which there is a complete preservation of the site architecture of the kidney. More important, we actually graded in a blindly fashion by one of the renal pathologists and the biopsies of the untreated group, the C1 treated, and the C1 plus heparin, and we see a dramatic reduction in the acute tubular injury, vascular thrombi, hemorrhagic cortical necrosis, and immune rejection process. What we see here in the upper corner is that the serum levels of C1 inhibitor is dramatically increased when we use heparin in combination with C1 inhibitor. We see a significant drop in the activity of the complement at the classic and MLB pathway, but not the alternative. See also, in biopsies performed at day 5 post-transplant, a significant reduction in the apoptotic bodies that were identified in glomeruli of kidneys or recipients of kidneys that received C1 inhibitor plus heparin. And this is actually one of the latest slides from Jose Torrealba, in which he was able to actually compare. If you recall, we have 7 animals that received vehicle. One of them was sacrificed at day 20, and the other ones was sacrificed at day 30. Those 2 animals were stained positive for C3D and C4D. What that means is that these animals have a significant complement deposition that is being called the presence of C3D and C4D in an animal model. What it shows is that it's an antibody-mediated rejection, likely triggered by the ischemic reperfusion injury and the incompatibility of the HLA typing. In contrast, animals that receive C1 inhibitor plus heparin, and this is a biopsy at day 30, we do not see C3D or C4D deposition, which speak about, you know, the benefit of donor pretreatment to prevent antibody-mediated rejection. Couple of slides about, you know, the prevention of fibrosis in kidneys. This was done in a rodent model in which we pretreat the animals before the injury with C1 inhibitor. This was instead of the non-human primate model in which we used 200 milligrams per kilo, we used 500 milligrams per kilo alone without combination of heparin. And what we see in this model is the following. If we actually were to treat animals with C1 inhibitor 60 minutes prior to the occlusion of the pedicle of the kidney, and we were to release, 65% of those animals were capable to be alive 30 days after. Only 15% of the animals survived the injury without treatment. So C1 inhibitor is allowing, and to increase the lethal survival of clamping the pedicle and doing a contralateral nephrectomy. The other thing that we did was we compared serum creatinines of animals that receive C1 inhibitor versus the ones that receive PVS, and we see actually significant difference in stereo serum creatinine at 24 and 72 hours. There is a dramatic, actually, also prevention in terms of the changes in the cytoarchitecture of the kidney. There is also a reduction in terms of deposit of macrophages and neutrophils into the graft. And there is also at day 90, what we did is that we compare the cytoarchitecture of the kidney. We did immunoperoxidase staining for alpha smooth muscle, Desmin, Picrocyrus red, and what we see in the panel on the left side, the D, H, and L, there is a significant reduction in terms of immunoperoxidase stainings for alpha smooth muscle, Desmin, and Picrocyrus red. And what that tells us is that there is a reduction in terms of fibrosis that is being induced by the treatment with C1 inhibitor. This is actually the quantification at day 30 and 90, and we see a statistical significant difference in terms of prevention of fibrosis. Some people have argued that the reason why we see less fibrosis in those kidneys are related to the decrease in macrophages and neutrophils to the graft. So what Sebastian tried to do here was to basically take renal tubular epithelial cells and stimulate their complement, and then ask the question as to whether they are able to release TGF-beta, which we know is one of the intermediaries of fibrosis, and whether C1 inhibitor is capable to prevent that. And we see here that there is a significant reduction in terms of TGF-beta deposition. There is actually a reduction of C5a, C5aase is what is called the anaphylatoxin. It's one of the intermediary of the complement system. And basically, the C5a, when it binds to its receptor, is leading to necrosis and apoptosis of the renal tubular epithelial cells. So what we see is that C1 inhibitor is capable to reduce the amount of C5a that is being released by those cells. It's also reducing caspase and, again, TGF-beta. So preliminary conclusions, this is a work in progress, is that C1 inhibitors in combination with heparin as a donor pretreatment strategy increase graft survival, prevents DGF, and improve renal function in non-human primates when it's combined with heparin in order to exacerbate their activity. Pretreatment with C1 inhibitors prior to renal ischemia reperfusion injury protect mice from developing fibrosis 90 days post-transplant and prevent the development of fibrosis in an ischemic reperfusion injury model. So this is actually the model that we're going to be pursuing over the next 5 years in order to try to mechanistically understand the reason why complement given to donors as a pretreatment strategy is capable to prevent, you know, this accelerated fibrosis process and is capable to prevent delayed graft function. Instead of doing it in younger animals, what we're going to be doing moving forward is utilizing expanded criteria donor equivalent animals. In other words, elder, you know, non-human primates. Those are the ones that mimic what we see in the clinic, and those are the patients that actually have a greater incidence of delayed graft function. Again, it's been a pleasure to be here. I need to thank Tony D'Alexandro, who has been a wonderful partner doing all these kidney transplants in non-human primates. Sebastian, for all the mechanistic studies. Unfortunately, we didn't have enough time to be able to show all the data that you have produced in order to be able to understand mechanistically why is this happening, and the people in my lab and my future collaborators in the next 5 years, which is Dr. Jamali, Will Burlingham, Jose Torrealba, Tom Ellis at the HLA typing lab, and Cees van Kooten, who is a complement and immunologist in the Netherlands. Again, thanks for your attention. I don't know how UW will look in the future, maybe a combination of a package or a kit that contain heparin, complement, and we might be able to add that, you know, to the UW solution when we go and do donor procurement. We'll see what the future brings. Thank you for your attention.